If you don't fake it, then we're cool. If you don't fake it, then we're cool. If you don't fake it, then we're cool. If you don't fake it, then you're cool.
This is prep time. This is Chef Ian's favorite time of day.
Yes. Before the Karens come.
It's a meditative sort of step, and he really just likes to take it easy for a little while. Look at this.
Oh! We brought beer and petite camembert.
And mulberry, noticing.
Yeah. Do you get berries on?
Noticing? Mulberry noticing. Can I reshoot that?
We cyberbullied an old lady into submission after she acted like a fucking dickhead. She like got blackout drunk and started harassing the staff and then like threw a bar stool.
Yeah, I was like, you're not going to talk to the staff that way.
Oh my God, yeah.
I'm sorry. And then she's like, how dare you talk to me like this? And she stood up and she threw a bar stool against the bar.
Yeah, and fucking...
Do you want water as well?
I'm just going to crush beers for now. It's been a stressful day for me.
It's beer o'clock.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
But anyway, this fucking woman was like... Ian goes out there to talk to her because she was having difficulty with her captain, right? And I walked past him because I was gathering something from the bar for, like, my station. And things are getting heated, and I walk by, and I hear Ian saying, like, okay, well, let's, you know, I don't want to begin to whatever...
Yeah, I was like, don't single out the staff members while they're standing right here next to us, you know?
Yeah.
You're not going to talk about somebody who's literally standing right here like they're not here.
Yeah. And so I walk by and I hear this, and then I pop over and I look at them like, is everything okay? What's going on? And she's like, yeah, who are you? I'm like, I'm the owner. What can I do for you? And she basically says, I went to Carbone last week. Do you know Max? So I was like, yeah, sure, I know Max. I don't know who the fuck she's talking about. And she's like, this Dover sole is dry and it's salty. And I looked her right in the eye and I said, it's perfect. Anything else? She said, no. And I told her, have a nice day. And then she was just like, wow.
How dare you talk to me like this? I can't believe. Then she tried to blame me. She tried to be like, I can't believe that you did that to me. I was like, what? Like, do you even know that? Like, he's like fucking a foot and a half taller than I am.
No, we look completely different.
My first question is, what is a Dover sole?
Dover sole is like, it's like a flatfish.
Okay.
It's, you know, there's like lemon sole and halibut, and they're all like in the flatfish family.
Okay.
And the Dover sole, I think turbot is one of those fish too. Dover sole just has nice, meaty flesh. We cook it on the bone. We do it piccata style, but piccata... Meunier, Grenoblois, they're all just these interchangeable sauces.
Okay.
You know, and yeah. But she said it was dry and it was salty, or that it was overcooked and it was salty. And I just looked her dead in the eye and I said, it's perfect. You don't know what you're talking about.
This is after we already, you know, typically you get in a situation like that, like customer dissatisfaction, right? You're like, you know.
If we fuck up, we'll be the first people to admit it.
Right.
Yeah.
But it's like, you know, somebody doesn't like something, whatever. Just take it off the check. Who cares? Like, it's not worth the energy, you know, as tightly as we run our place. It's not worth the energy for one of us to have to go out there and, like, fucking give this lady a hand job. You know?
Yeah. This chick also had, like, four bottles of Merlot, and she was like, you could tell she was, like, old lady drunk.
Yeah.
Like, mom drunk.
So she starts getting a little like sassy with us, and we're just not having it. And so Eric's like, "Yeah, your fish was cooked perfectly and seasoned perfectly, so you're welcome." And then she looks at me and she's like, "I can't believe that you would have done something like that to me." You know,
she thought it was Ian talking to her. That's how fucking fucked up this lady was.
And I was like, "You know, I'm sorry you feel that way. You know, I took it off your check. I don't know what else you would like me to do for you. You know, you said you didn't want anything else. Here's your check." You know, and she's like, that's it. I'm reviewing this place right now. This is disgusting. Your place, your restaurant is disgusting. You're disgusting. Ooh. And she like she stands up.
This is in front of a packed dining room. Sorry, context, but packed.
Yeah, packed dining room.
What time was that?
We got 40 seats. There was 38 of them were not these two people. It was like 7 o'clock on Thursday or Friday night. And she stands up and she throws her bar stool against the bar. And I was like, you're not going to damage my property. You can leave now.
Ian swings around the bar.
I swing around the bar and like start to escort her out. She's like, don't fucking touch me.
No, her friend. So yeah, Ian like motions his hand behind her as she's already kind of like starting to stumble out. And her one friend was like, don't touch her. Like, he's not doing anything. You're just getting kicked out because you act like...
Right, and you might fall over at any point in time, so clearly I have to stand here.
Yeah.
To make sure you don't fall into these tables full of people. So this woman stands up, throws her bar stool, and then I like swim around the bar to start walking around. She grabs her open bottle of wine off the counter and like is like covering the top with her thumb and like, you know, wobbling out of the dining room. And she she leaves. The other woman's like, I'm so embarrassed. I was like, I guess your meal was on us tonight. See you later. Or never again. Yeah. And then like they walk out the door and everybody kind of turns to us and we're like, I think they had a bit too much to drink. And like everyone in the dining room is either like applauding or like bursts out in laughter.
I was doing damage control as Ian was escorting them out because I was still on the bar. Yeah. And when Ian went to, I saw her throw the bar stool. Uh-huh. And Ian immediately swings around the bar to escort them out. I stayed behind the bar and I told her friend, if you don't leave, we're going to call the police. And I said it loud enough so that other people could around her could hear.
Yeah.
What was going on? And as they were walking out, I just started cracking jokes with the guests sitting at the bar. Like, I'm sorry, she had like four too many bottles of wine. I apologize. Everybody okay? Are you all right? Like, fucking everyone was just like fucking laughing.
How were tips after that?
Great.
Pretty generous.
Yeah,
I'm sure.
No, we actually made more than we normally would.
Of course. Yeah. So maybe stage that. In the future.
I'm sure.
If you need an actor, I don't know. I might know a guy.
Karen for hire.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
we were laughing about it in the kitchen for like the next half hour, and we just like whatever start looking her up. Normal things normal people do. We start doing background checks on her. White pages.
Yeah.
We start
Find her address.
Yeah, I contact my friends from the State Department. You know, I find out what her license plate number is. All of these things.
Honest. I guess I'm just gonna choose to believe it.
And whatever, we do a little bit of work on her. We find her Instagram account, and she posts this thing on Instagram, all caps in the caption, like, this place is disgusting. It should close. Yada yada. And I was just like, that's it. I'm gonna rally the fucking team. We're gonna go after her. Her like her account was public and whatever.
Yeah.
Anyway, we
public
just,
account, public post, 250 followers,
and we proceed
on her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah, and we proceed to defend ourselves aggressively. And like her engagement on her other posts is like she had one other post with like 8 comments, another post with like 4 comments,
12 likes.
Yeah, and then after whatever, the writers engage. It's like 112 comments, and it's all just like, you fucking drunk bitch, Karen. Yeah.
You made a fucking fool of yourself. How dare you? How dare you?
And then like all these random people, like fans of the restaurant, start like coming in.
Chiming in like,
yo, you should sue her. Sue her ass. Sue her. Like they start chanting the comments.
God. Yeah, somebody was like, you must have COVID because you got no taste, lady. Like just corny comments.
Some comments were like serious. And like actually like argumentative, and some of them were just fucking silly. Like I said, you smell like mothballs. and that comment got more engagement than any other one I posted. And she wrote, Are you 2 years old? And I was like, yeah.
here and there, yeah.
Pretty sure.
Yeah.
Later that night she took the post down, made her account private. So
really?
Yeah, so we neutralized the threat.
Yeah.
That's
great.
Well, you know, the thing is, like, having worked for big restaurant groups and stuff, like, every time somebody leaves, like, a negative Yelp review, which everyone knows is, like, a platform for bitching and complaining, that's, like, people don't go on Yelp to write nice things.
No.
No.
They're trying to get free food or whatever.
Yep, right. You know, so, like, having seen that for so long, and especially after COVID, it's like, dude, like, nobody cares anymore. It's like, oh, you want to weaponize your review? Like, you're probably not going to... If you had such a bad time, why should I beg you to come back?
A little thing with that, it's not that I don't think nobody cares anymore. It's just all the wrong people care. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's really
true.
Where I feel it comes from. And it's like, people will say shit on the internet that they'll never say in person.
Of course, yeah.
Like, and people think, like, they go to a restaurant and, you know, they start shit, get kicked out of the restaurant, and they think they can do damage control by... shitting on an establishment, and that's not the case with us. It simply isn't. I won't have that.
You're not gonna stand there and then like demean the staff, personally insult me.
No.
And then
insult my cooking.
Right.
Fuck out of here.
And then like, and when I tell you to like, you know, okay, you know, try to be diplomatic with you and do the right thing, you know, just for you to turn around and be a total fucking raging bitch anyway. Yeah. It's like, you know, what is there? What's there to lose?
Yeah, nothing.
You know? I already comped the most expensive thing on your check.
Right. For, what's that?
The Dover Soul.
Oh.
The, I mean, they
her
they
soul? Were at the restaurant. Yeah. You comped her soul.
Yeah,
her
it's like, soul. Yeah.
God, there's a joke in there somewhere.
It's in there. It's in there. We'll eke it out by the end, hopefully.
That was the most exciting day of the week.
Her soul was fucking salty and overcooked.
Yeah, her soul was definitely overcooked by the end of the night, that's for sure. Fucking withering. Beached soul.
Yeah. There's like, for the most part, like we know, like when we're running service in the back, in the kitchen, we know almost where everyone's meal is at, how long everyone's waiting, you know, the order in which people's food hits the table, stuff like that. We're in control of a lot of things just from like the information we have in the kitchen.
Yeah.
And mistakes happen. It's a busy-ass restaurant. Mistakes happen in every restaurant.
Right.
Super high-end, whatever, casual, low-end, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And you identify it, you admit that you have a problem, and then you resolve it, and then that's just usually how it goes, and there's not an issue. But when a lady just gets blackout and belligerent like that, like you have to respond differently.
Of course.
So, yeah.
It's just
with extreme force.
Yeah, it's just a respect thing, you know? Like, you wouldn't, you know, like, for instance, she's a real estate agent, you know? She had somebody, you know, treating her that way as a real estate agent, I'm sure she wouldn't want to work with them either.
Well, I'm
going to like, move on to the next client, you know?
I have that. I'm going to have that on the show one time.
A real estate agent?
No, somebody treating me that way.
I hope you
that
don't.
That would be the goal, yeah.
I hope you don't.
And we can role play it right now.
You should invite. You should invite like a
3%. No, that's okay. I've got neighbors. I should invite that woman, huh?
Or yeah, you could. Yeah,
fine. Maybe we could a reconciliation episode.
I can help you find her easily.
We'll get her to cook for you.
Adam paints a scene from Maury.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it really would be like 90s television. I kind of want this.
90s TV needs to come back.
Like, yeah, that's
reality
I mean,
TV
I'd love that.
Turn into like whatever VH1 style, like surreal life shit.
Yeah.
Like Maury and Springer and all that shit.
Mm-hmm.
I want to be able to watch that, like, you know, at night when I get home from work. Like instead of like Jimmy
Geraldo,
instead of like Jimmy Fallon or you know.
Yeah.
Geraldo was a fucking motherfucker.
I mean, Geraldo, like, remember the episode? We watched that episode. He had G.G. Allen on.
He had G.G. Allen on, but he also had, like, some white supremacist dude on that started a fight.
With, like, some evangelicals or some shit.
No, there was this guy. It was like a black guy. He was some kind of scholarly guy. I forget all the details, but he was, like, insulting him. And the black dude like starts choking him, and then a riot breaks out, and somebody throws a fucking chair, like a wooden chair, in Geraldo's face and breaks his nose. And then Geraldo like regains himself, picks up the microphone, and he's like, "We'll be right back after these messages."
They spoofed that in UHF with Weird Al, didn't they?
Did they?
Yeah. You know, before you guys walked in, I was hoping I'd get to mention Weird Al tonight. I swear to God.
Okay, yeah.
How's that synchronicity?
Yeah.
That quick.
That's perfect.
That quick, just like that.
We found it.
The Weird Al link.
Did you see they're making a Weird Al movie with fucking Daniel Radcliffe?
Is he gonna play Weird Al?
Yeah.
Weird.
Yeah, he's like ripped. He's like weird and ripped, and it's on some, I think it's on like gonna be on some streaming service that's like a C tier streaming service, like Crackle.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I don't know what Crackle is.
Yeah, no, yeah,
it's a free one. Yeah. I think I watched. What did I watch?
It's like a service you get with your Fire Stick.
You know? Yeah. It's okay. What did I watch on Crackle though? One time I watched Easy Rider. I watched Easy Rider on Crackle.
Okay. With ads or without ads?
I can't remember. It was COVID, so I was probably just drunk all day.
I'm ready. I'm ready for my next beer.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Adam, can I go get another beer?
Go for it. Go right ahead.
Yeah.
You know, just don't both get up at the same time.
Okay.
So then I'll just be, well, even if you did that, I would just work on the mantle behind you. So I've always got something to paint.
Gotcha. Can you make me look good? Can you give me like a beauty filter?
That is something I can't do.
No.
Can you make me look less fat?
Not for anybody.
Yeah, can you make me look more muscular, less fat? Can you do like a Korean beauty filter?
Can we also get like however
afterwards, after it's done, after it's dry, I'll go back in. We'll do a nice little glaze.
Can we get the Budweiser?
Rose your cheeks up a bit and just make it. Yeah.
Can we get the Budweiser graveyard in here too? Don't forget the Budweiser graveyard.
Okay, I'm gonna see if
there's gonna be a bunch of them.
Is the Budweiser graveyard in? It is in the shot, just the tops of the cans. So keep them toward the back, and then
gotcha,
and then it'll be there.
We'll do a little.
We could make that scene a little more interesting too.
Sure.
Why don't we do that? I'm going to. Has
anyone ever sorry. Pardon me.
Ooh. It's like a fire.
Yes. Should we be using the coasters? I feel like we should be.
No, it's a plastic table. I don't give a shit. That table will be replaced eventually. I've got a new chair that's coming for the desk tomorrow.
It's nice.
Very ugly from Wayfair.
Is this where editing happens?
Yes. Cool. I spend all day doing that. Just did all day today. Up until like an hour ago.
I like that you're just straight up using a TV as your monitor. I did that for years.
Yeah, why not? It's fine.
Yeah, it works.
For that purpose, I'm not working on color or anything like that. It's a stage. I'm just editing all the stuff.
I used an Emerson 42-inch TV that I bought for like $200 at Walmart.
Yeah?
As my computer monitor for years. And I'm pretty sure it damaged my eyes somehow.
That's how I feel when I watch the TV in the basement. I'll watch maybe 3-4 episodes of something.
Cool.
And I'll like stand up at the end of it and I'll be like,
I'll
look myself in the mirror and I'm like bloodshot on one side of my eyeball.
Is it a big one? Or is it just that it's so sharp or something?
All of the above.
Yeah.
It's just like staring at blue light at night for hours and hours. It's not the best.
Do you lose sleep because of that? I've talked with some people recently who work in IT and just they spend all their life in front of a screen, and he said he still sleeps like a baby, which is surprising. I feel like I hear the opposite is true of
most people. It's not like I'm looking at a screen every other day most of the day.
No.
Usually I'm just running around under LED lights.
Yeah, LED lights, or it's just like our faces are on our phones all the time.
You must have lights that are kind of similar in color to this. There must be white lights in the kitchen, right?
Yeah.
Cool.
White LEDs, yeah.
Like studio lighting. That's we're the same in that way.
Yeah. Well, we like we dim them during service so that it's not too jarring going out of the kitchen into the dining room. Because the dining room is like
maybe a beaded curtain. It's going to help.
Yeah, the dining room is actually kind of like poorly lit, intentionally, but
sure.
Poorly, dimly. it's dimly lit.
Like, but even at nighttime when you turn the lights all the way up, it doesn't get very bright in there. For like cleaning purposes and stuff. Like you need LED lights in the kitchen.
You would need for sure an additional light, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean like the kitchen lighting, it's a little bit too strong to keep on full power all the time.
Yeah.
It would be really nice to have a curtain between like the kitchen and the dining room.
Yeah.
To drown some of it out and
you do that?
Make it feel more grand in terms of like an entrance or an exit between the two spaces.
Sure.
But it would get so fucking dirty so quickly.
Yeah. Well, and it would get in the way of everything. It would, that would be impossible.
It's like such a tight space already. Yeah.
Just bumping into that would drive everyone nuts.
You got like plates full of rigatoni. All of a sudden your curtain's stained with rigatoni sauce.
Yeah, they would be.
Like first day.
They would get fucked. Yeah.
What would it be, like the Bob Marley one? The
Bob Marley beat?
His face.
Yeah, a marijuana leaf.
Yeah.
Maybe.
I think beads would be cool for the patio. I still think that.
That's actually not, that's not
but like
impossible to imagine.
Instead of Bob, like Tony Soprano.
That's pretty funny.
Or
have you seen our Tony shrine in the back? We made a shrine to Antonio Soprano.
I'll check it out. And,
little candles.
We'll do a nice little scene. We'll do.
Yeah, there's like we have like a church chalice, and like a rosary, and a saintly candle of Carmela.
That's pretty cool.
And then just a picture of
people find it funny. Every now and again, I just see people walk by it, and they just fucking start laughing. Like, yo, look at this! Like, look at idiots are doing. Like, what is this?
so many restaurants, they just take themselves so seriously.
Of course,
you know?
It's
and it's not that we don't take ourselves seriously.
We take our
work
seriously.
But it's like exactly. You know, everything else, it's like you're here at the restaurant, they have a good time.
Yeah.
You know?
You don't go to Great America to deal with like a cracked out Tweety Bird walk around character or something. It's not like it's not like anyone's going to be upset if they have a nice time.
Right.
Except for the one.
Except one unless they really want to have a bad time.
Except for that bitch.
Then we'll, then we will verifiably guaranteed make sure they have a bad time. No,
we're going to fucking rally the riders. We're going to rally the fucking Sub-Zero, the Frosty Riders.
They're going to have such a bad time, it's going to follow them home. Mm-hmm. And live in that thing.
They're going to remember it for the rest of their life.
So
you know, word to the wise, if you're listening to this podcast.
If you're listening to this fucking
podcast. If you plan to come out to our restaurant and not have a good time, don't come.
Yeah, just get drunk and be really happy. And pay for your food and leave, even if you don't like it.
Yeah.
And don't start shit on social media. Mm-hmm.
Well, for that matter, on any subject... Don't start shit on any subject around any subject on social media.
Yeah.
Just have a nice time.
Just have a nice time. A real nice time.
And if you don't have a good time, then you don't have to go back, and that's that, you know?
Yeah. Boy. Can you imagine people writing reviews on Yelp? Can you like imagine for a second like people writing reviews on Yelp thinking that they're like making an impact? That they're like what I have to say matters. My opinion is fucking
I think it's possible.
Really fucking
one instance I could imagine would matter would be at a mechanic shop.
Okay.
Yeah.
Speaking of mechanic shops, didn't somebody fucking smash up your car?
Yes, they did.
Oh, yeah. Did you find them?
No, I found what kind of car they drove, but...
I gotta get my boys on it. I gotta get my riders on it.
Mm-hmm.
State Department.
Yeah.
Do you want us to track them down?
I'm not sure what we would do. I mean, judging by the car he was driving and his mentality to do what he did.
Cut this out. We got to cut this.
Yeah, I mean, I figure we're cutting about
it. We found it. We found the subject. We should discuss on air.
Yeah. No need to cry though.
Yeah. Gotcha. Do you plan on monetizing or doing Patreon or Gumroad or something?
I don't think I'm gonna do Patreon. I'm just gonna kind of offer this as a service and just think of it like I've taken so much from people my entire life.
That's a beautiful outlook. That's a really good way to look at things. But at the same time, like if your viewership like whatever exceeds 100,000 people or something.
Yeah. Well, dream scenario, yeah, of course.
Yeah.
And I think that my goal is to continue to make this into something that I care about and I'm like actually that I love.
Yeah.
That I want to do just you know, without compromising to anyone in any way.
Yeah. Compromising to people fucking sucks.
Well that's yeah.
Like the reason we started our restaurant.
You do it so many ways in life, and I think that this is a good opportunity for me to just say, okay, this is all self-funded. This is nobody can say a word to me about anything I'm doing.
Yeah.
You know, in relation to it. And most advice that I get is bad advice because it's from people who don't do this, and it's just
everybody wants to tell you. You know what I realized? You know, through the process of getting this whole restaurant
mm-hmm.
set up and like going through all this fucking bullshit with the liquor license that the city's putting us through and everything else, it's like. Uh-huh. Everybody wants to tell you like, hey, I can help you with this, or like, oh, you should really do it this way, or whatever. Yeah. Everybody wants to put an input, but they got no skin in the game. Yeah. So they feel like, and like to themselves, they feel like, oh, I'm helping this guy out. They're just getting started, or they're just doing this. Mm. And when really it's just like, you know, it just makes me want to try harder. It makes both of us, I think, want to try harder to be able to tell those people like, go fuck yourself, you don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
You know? It's like this whole online review thing. Like if somebody who worked in a restaurant group did that, they'd get fucking shit canned for mm-hmm. sure.
I don't even respond to that kind of shit. I've had so many people tell me that, oh, I'm gonna get you a liquor license. Mm-hmm. I know people downtown.
Funny.
Yeah, it's like, well, fucking great, cool. What's it gonna cost me? And then what's it gonna cost me on your end and on their end? And when is it actually gonna happen? Because I don't know, from the process that Ian has described to me,
mm-hmm.
it's you're basically just dealing with an expediter, and then like 10 separate entities. Whatever that work for the that
all different city departments that don't talk to each other but are supposed to be talking to each other.
They don't communicate with each other, and then they if one of them doesn't follow through, the entire thing is held up. And it's really difficult to coordinate people who just don't communicate with each other.
Yeah.
Doing something that's so, I don't know.
It matters a lot to us. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, they don't give a fuck. Yeah, no. It's
like, you guys are celebrating your year pretty soon, aren't you?
Yeah, we are.
Was it September 14th?
Yeah, September 14th. Cool. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, how are we going to celebrate that? What are we going to do?
Shoot guns into the sky.
That's a great idea.
I mean, honestly,
let's throw mortars. Let's light mortars and throw them.
Just throw them in the middle of Grand Avenue. Yeah.
Or maybe we could put that slingshot of yours to work. Don't you have like a fucking?
Oh yeah. So like slingshot. So as like a kid, when I was in scouts, we there was like one of the assistant scoutmasters. Every summer we go up to the fucking summer camp.
We could launch them. We could theoretically and launch them at a certain mayor of Chicago's house.
Certain politician. might be kind of short. Looks like Beetlejuice. So we had this, we called it a winger, but it was like a three-person slingshot, and we would, they'd have these canoe things on the lake, and we would go down to the shore of the lake, and we'd take all of like the oranges and the fruit that they would give us all week, and we'd start launching them out at these people in canoes in the lake.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you hit anybody?
We'd get kind of close. I mean, it's like
you never actually made contact.
Like once in a while you like maybe broadside somebody, but it's like you got to put a lot of ammo downrange. It's not terribly accurate, you know, unless your target is like a house.
What distance were you shooting these fruit over at people?
I mean, I think those things are rated. Like, you'd shoot an orange probably about 250, 300 yards.
300 fucking yards.
Yeah.
Jeez. And your targets are people.
So how do you, they're canoes with people in them.
Yeah. That's fucking cool. I wish I went to camp.
I mean, they're made for shooting water balloons.
You know what I would
have gotten? How do you secure them?
I would have gotten the headshot. First try.
Do you drive a spike into the ground, or how do you secure
it? No. So one person holds each side of the slingshot. There's two handles, and it's like a big piece of surgical tube.
Okay.
And then there's like a little basket or like it's like a piece of cloth, the handle on it. Mm-hmm. And then the third person grabs it, and two people hold it like this. And then the third person grabs it, and they yank it all the way down to the ground.
That's why it's not accurate.
Let go.
Yeah. No, you need a platform that swivels, that kind of pivots.
Now they do like on like Fear Factor, they used to show ones of that where like people would shoot watermelons with them. The problem is every once in a while they can like wrap around and like kind of like the thing will fall out, and then the thing will slap back and shoot whatever it is at your face.
Right, and then you die.
Yeah.
So, or you're really retarded forever.
Moral of the story is I always wanted one as a kid, but I could never find one. This is like before Amazon and shit. So
I feel like there was an episode of Malcolm in the Middle where they like build one on their roof and they like launch eggs in their neighborhood or something.
Yeah, they were like built a trebuchet or some shit. Yeah.
No, like one of those things, but it was like fixed on their roof.
Yeah. So it can be done. Anyway, so I bought one on Amazon for like $20 a couple months ago.
Have you used it yet?
No, I haven't used it yet. I need more than one person to use it.
Have you showed Sam your kneel for the cross, stand for the flag?
No.
That I bought for you?
No, I haven't shown her that. I think about swapping it out for my Gaston flag in the garage, which already freaks my neighbors out enough.
Well, yeah. No, I mean, the Gaston flag is like whatever.
That's
like
some colonial shit. That's some American shit.
It's like colonial shit.
It's been co-opted by...
That's not like some January 6th.
No,
not at all.
No.
Not at all.
Kneel for the flag, stand for the cross.
No, kneel for the cross,
kneel for the cross, stand for the flag.
I think. I don't know what the fuck
I can't remember.
I like to buy joke gifts. I bought Ian this fucking flag on Amazon. I found for like $8. There's like all of these like fucking like Punisher flags with like the American flag
right
over like the Punisher logo.
Sure. Yeah.
There's so many of them. They get really crazy. But yeah. I got it for Ian. I just sent it to his house.
Do you get those at truck stops, or do you get them online?
Well, I was looking for a flag for a restaurant, an Italian flag, on Amazon, and I just look up Italian flag, and suddenly there's like the Blue Lives Matter flag,
right?
And like kneel for the cross, stand for the flag, and then there's like
and it's like a G.I. Joe caricature, like saluting the United States flag, and then like a guy like praying. at a cross.
Yeah, right. Like kneeling.
And fucking, what the fuck else? What the fuck else was there? I'm struggling to like think of examples. There was like a picture of an AR-15 and like, come and take it.
Yeah.
Like, who's gonna fucking fly that flag?
Some hillbilly.
Yeah.
Somebody, yeah.
There is so much of that shit out there. It's hilarious.
Oh, yeah.
And like, the thing is, it's like, it's a flag too. So when, you know, when people like put it on the back of their pickup truck, they think they're making a statement. They're like, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm making a fucking statement right now.
I got
caught. I'm making a difference.
There was a guy. Oh, my God. There was a guy who was blasting the new Kid Rock song.
There's a new Kid Rock song?
There are several new Kid Rock songs.
What? He released a new album?
It's so hilarious, I just don't even want to tell you a single thing about it.
Okay.
I think you need to see it for the first time totally
blind. We're going to listen to it tomorrow.
You need to listen totally blind, watch the music videos. You just need to go into it.
Have you heard the new Limp Bizkit?
Total faith.
Limp Bizkit still sucks. Speaking of faith. I think the album is called Limp Bizkit Still Sucks.
I believe that.
Yeah, and it's...
Does he... I know that he was back on tour. He like changed his whole style. He was doing this dad look, and he had these red aviator sunglasses and stuff. Yeah. Did you see that?
Last year at Lollapalooza, he looked like one of the guys out of the Sabotage music video.
Mm-hmm. I love his rebrand. I really love his
rebrand. It was a good one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And there's like skits on that album. You know what? I'm not going to tell you about that.
He kept, well, you know what my suspicion was of... was that he couldn't wear... He had to change his brand because... This is my hot take on Limp Bizkit's new look.
Go off.
Because he can't wear the red baseball cap anymore because that's been taken by a very specific group of people.
Yeah, you know.
I'm guessing that his PR or somebody came in and said, you can't wear the red baseball cap anymore. We can't do that anymore.
Yeah.
So he's like, how about red sunglasses? You know, it's still got that same...
That's fair.
A tinge of the Durst.
I have kind of an issue with, like, the whole taking things thing. It's like, you know, like...
Oh, I don't think...
Like, the Proud Boys and the 3%ers took Gadsden flag.
It's a corporate response to something. It's not, like, a real thing.
The Make America Great Again people took red hats away. It's like, we can't wear red hats anymore.
That's
like,
right. It's silly.
You can't give them that power over you. You know what I mean? Like, no. What are they going to take next? Fucking...
Hot dogs.
Big Macs? Yeah, you eat a hot dog, you're whatever, a Nazi or something. That's yeah. Bullshit.
You eat a Frankfurter, all of a sudden you're a Nazi?
Right.
You eat a brat?
So I gotta get more beers.
Any kind of worst or whatever, I don't know. Should have brought a cooler.
I know.
That's fine. That could have worked.
Do you need one?
No, I got this. I've got this tall one. I'm just kind of nursing it.
So Fred Durst wouldn't wear a red hat because of Trump? Is that what you're saying, Adam?
I suspect this. Okay. And I'm willing to put it out there into the world.
Got it. Okay, fair.
Well, you know, let freedom ring, baby.
Yeah.
Yeah. From our friends.
Amen to that.
From our friends at Anheuser-Busch.
Or his PR people, you know, thought it was a bad idea. His branding, his marketing, marketing strategy was not, it wasn't safe, you know, to go out like that. It was like it's too big of a risk, Fred.
Yeah, well, it's so funny for someone whose attitude, like forever, their entire brand is being like, fuck you and fuck this.
Yeah.
Or whatever. Give me a chainsaw. Give me something to break.
Right.
They named their new album Limp Bizkit Still Sucks. And the fact that there's a marketing team behind that being like, don't wear a red hat, Fred.
You know, I have a limp because of Limp Bizkit.
Did you get caught in a pit or something?
I sprained my knee at a house party making fun of the fact that they were playing Limp Bizkit
at
the party, like break stuff. So I like was dancing like an asshole. Yeah. And I sprained my knee, and I had to immediately go home and be like, oh, God, and I was on crutches. And that was directly from...
That's what Limp Bizkit makes people do.
That's a direct line. I can draw that.
That's what makes it... Yeah, Limp Bizkit makes people of a certain demographic act like that.
Mm-hmm. That was a good 14-plus years ago.
Yeah.
That was a while ago.
Yeah. So, Adam, I think I was reading one of your... one of your posts on your blog, and did you used to be a Jehovah's Witness?
Yeah, I grew up that way.
You have a blog?
Yeah.
I know about
triptycho.art. So I write this arts and culture blog with these two other artists, this Brazilian artist who I met when we were both studying in Norway. And then we just stayed in touch. We stayed good friends. We're such good friends. And really believe in each other's careers and just as
that's awesome.
Each other as people. It's awesome. And then Trevor, who Bruno introduced me to, who's a printmaker who lives in Wisconsin. He's very smart. His prints are very intricate and very classically influenced and really modern or contemporary in the subject matter. But still in the practice, you just feel like you're looking at something kind of ancient in some ways. It's cool.
That's cool.
But so these two guys and I have this arts and culture blog called Triptico, which is spelled Triptico.
Yeah.
So the website is triptico.art. And we write about different stuff. So
that's cool.
I'm trying to treat it as a gossip column.
I love that.
Because
those are the best blogs.
I want to let this shit out. So I've been writing, I've been journaling for 16 years, like 3 pages every day.
Wow.
You know, you miss a lot of days, but you can still generally say that.
No, I hear you.
These days, it's certainly every day religiously. I don't miss a day. And wow. That's given me a kind of language that I was never really able to share with people.
Yeah.
So I just kind of kept that to myself. And it's just sort of like, all right, I've got this whole language of writing. And it's this stream of consciousness kind of style. But I bring out insightful stuff in these pages I'm writing. No one will ever see. Be great if they were destroyed after I died. I never.
It's very zen of you.
No one should ever see that stuff. That's not made for other people. That's why it's good.
Yeah.
So it's like it was a place to develop that voice, and now Triptico is a place where I can actually use it.
There's
so
one thing that's I'm scared cool, of doing, and it's journaling. I'm afraid to write my thoughts down.
Yeah, that's been it's.
I'm fucking scared to put them on paper.
It's been one of the most amazing things.
Yeah.
You know people.
Well, I mean, I know people that journal, and I know people who write diaries or have had diaries and yada, 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 all this stuff, and I understand kind of like the therapeutic angle of it, but I just don't want to write my thoughts down.
It's nuts for visualizing just what you want and understanding that, you know, what's actually in your way or whatever it is. It doesn't all have to be positive like that, but it's so much comes out of it that it's like, if I'm writing every single day for, you know, months-long period... I'm never writing about negative stuff anymore. I'm never going to it in the morning and complaining. But if I take weeks off, for the first thing I do is just write a solid page or two of complaining. And it's just this is bad. This is bad. I'm a victim because of this or that. And I hate this person or like this person did this thing. And, or it's like it's a space to complain when it's like that. But then when you're doing it every single day, you exhaust yourself on complaining in those pages. So it's like you really have these breakthroughs that are natural, like naturally occurring breakthroughs. And I've come up with some amazing creative ideas through that, you know, that whole process. It's really cool. It's a very strong method of just kind of...
it's like a method.
I don't know what.
Yeah.
I don't know what. And it's like everything at once. Yeah.
Do you chaos. Do you read what you write? Do you like go back?
I make
to
notes
archives?
In the margins. In the past year, I started typing. So I would write it by hand for all those years, 15 years of writing it by hand in journals. So I have these like big Rubbermaid things full of journals. And then, you know, I would write notes in the margins or I would underline things when I thought something was insightful or useful maybe down the road. But most of the time, it's just sort of like, I don't know, word salad, just kind of vomiting up the page, like just sometimes writing a whole page where I just write like, I don't want to be writing right now. I don't want to be writing right now. I don't want to be writing right now. Just it's like, but, and then the act of doing that makes you like, okay. And you get past it and you start writing. It's really, really a cool practice, in my opinion. A lot of people would say that's uncool, I'm sure.
Is it still journaling if you write things down and throw them away? Do you have to keep them?
You don't have to keep them. No. And you're actually, I mean, I got this practice from a book called The Artist's Way. And it's by this woman, Julia Cameron. And she has this whole spiritual approach to the whole thing. She uses the word God a lot. It doesn't bother me anymore. It used to bother me. But I think
I like how you say the word God.
Well, I mean...
She doesn't talk about... You don't say... She talks about God a lot. She uses the word God a lot.
Yeah, I think that would be like a knee-jerk reaction to me. Whenever I would see it written, I'd be like, oh, this person's word is worth nothing. It's like, you know, it's like, for some reason, like, growing up in that religion just kind of made it so that I thought I had to go in the complete opposite direction. I thought I had to do the polar opposite, like how the devil and God will never see each other because they're on two sides of the same coin. So we can never look at both sides at once or something. It's like that you think you have to go that polar opposite. You think you have to do the complete reverse of what your upbringing was. So you pursue the darkest thing. You pursue like the most vicious, intense life experiences. And it's like, really didn't need to go that far. I guess I appreciate the scope. The mention of the word God would be like a discrediting thing in the past. And now I see it and I'm just sort of like, yeah, that's okay. That's fine. We all have our own relationships with these things. It's perfectly acceptable for Kanye to sing songs about God.
Talking about God, like, as a metaphor, not like a physical, actual thing that exists, right?
I don't know.
Okay. It sounds like more of a metaphor.
Well, I don't know. And I think that I can't say that I know. So if I say that I know, that seems like I'm an insane person. I don't know. That's where I'm at now, as far as my relationship with God goes.
Hey, the same argument can be applied to vaccines, to that COVID vaccine.
Yeah. Right?
If I say I know, I sound like I'm crazy.
Yeah.
I say I don't know.
I think it's about the same, yeah. It's just a straight line.
Like, yeah. So do you have to like go around and ring doorbells and shit?
Yeah. Oh my God. Okay. My
here we go again with that guy.
My high school crush. Not high school, grade school crush. I wound up going to this girl's house who I had a crush on as a kid.
Yeah. Did you fuck her?
No.
No.
Somebody had to.
It was bound to happen sooner or later.
Yeah. So I knock on this door when we're out in service and I have this, you know, the literature in my hand. And this girl, the one who I have the biggest crush on in all the school, answers the door. And I have to just say, hi, can you give this to your mom? Like, as this small boy, that's one of the most embarrassing moments in my life, definitely. And
was her response negative or something?
No, it was just that level of embarrassment and sort of like being unmasked, you know? You're like, my God, the shame.
Right, now she knows I'm in a cult.
Yeah. Oh, God, so much shame attached to that in that moment. It was like oof.
Gotcha.
So, That was definitely the worst single experience in my memory of doing that. The rest of the time, it was just sort of like quietly knocking on the door and hoping they didn't hear and stuff like that. It wasn't like...
Was there
anyone... I never had the zeal. I just did what I was told.
Have you heard the good news?
Has anyone... Were there like somebody in a car like following you, making sure you were actually knocking on doors?
No, I mean, we would go out in groups. It wasn't just like selling... like Girl Scout cookies or something. We would go out.
Window siding?
Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay. Gotcha. Because if I was like running solo in grade school with like a stack of pamphlets.
Oh no, it wasn't like that ever.
Yeah, I would just like fucking throw them out and fuck off.
Throw them in a ditch and go fucking smoke weed somewhere?
Yeah. Yeah. I'd go like start a small fire somewhere in the woods and like whatever, fuck around and
burn them all.
I'd come back and be like, yeah, I got members. I got members. They'll call you. They'll be in touch.
With a book of matches you took from a restaurant one time.
Yeah. Or you'd grow up to be Michael Jackson, you know?
Yes. Is he Jehovah's Witness?
Yeah, he was raised Jehovah's Witness.
You know who else was Jehovah's Witness?
Prince?
Yeah.
But he was a convert. Too, which is more intense to, you know.
I thought he was raised that way.
Wow. Okay, now I've questioned myself enough to not know. Hey, Siri.
It's the only one way to solve this.
When did Prince become a Jehovah's Witness?
Okay,
Maybe I'm just assuming that because I figured there was no other way to be a Jehovah's Witness other than to be raised in it.
Yes, he became... He would flip-flop. Wait. I can't look at that right now. I gotta paint. Do you want to look at this?
Why'd you stop?
Stop painting?
Jehovah's. witnessing Jehovah.
I just turned 16. I witnessed a lot of stuff in the family. I'm the youngest of five, and I don't know. I was just sort of like, I mean, this doesn't seem like it's doing any of us any good. It seems like this is really an extreme sort of experience of the world. And, you know, you kind of just want to fit in when you're raised as an outsider. So,
yeah,
that I could not do and I still cannot. And that is A-okay.
I have a funny story. I was baptized Russian Orthodox when I was a little kid. And
what's that like?
You know, they throw water on you. You go to a big, like, gilded church. The Russian churches are super duper baller.
Yeah. So that's kind of haphazard the way you describe that. They throw water on you?
Yeah, no. They splash you with water, and they... I was a very, very little kid. Mm-hmm. I remember cookies, like weird bitter cookies. With like frosting on them and Rainbow Jimmies, just bad pastries. I remember like a really baller church. They hit you with water, and then everyone's really nice to you while you're there, and then you leave, and then you're a part of the gang, and you get a cross, you get a gold cross. And I remember this was when I was like kindergarten age.
Cool.
I threw away the cross, and I started shit with my parents.
Because as a 5-year-old,
yeah. Oh, yeah. And I was like, you never asked me if I wanted to be in this religion. I'm not interested. And they're like, where is your cross? We were fucking, like, poor when we came here. We were not. They're like, where's your fucking gold cross, Eric? And I was like, I threw it out!
Oh, we smuggled that all the way from the Soviet Union.
No, they bought it. It wasn't like solid. It had to have been plated or something. But they spent like some crazy amount of money, like $240. Just, you know, like something, you know, sure, which would have been insane back then.
Yeah.
For us, for the amount of money that we had. Mm-hmm. And I fucking threw it out because I was so pissed that, like, you know, I don't want to be a fucking part of this shit. You're making new shit I don't want to do.
I'm not an ingrate.
Yeah, and they just took turns beating me, and I would like cry and shit, and I would like take it, you know, and I would fucking take it like, you got more, like, and they would fucking take turns and shit. Yeah, I think I remember my parents kind of like getting tired of hitting me, and like looking at each other like, we fucked up, haven't we? This is gonna be a fucking problem, this guy. And then that was the end of religion in my life. I never went to church again. I went to church once when my great-grandmother died with my mom, you know, out of respect. Uh-huh. It was hard on my
tradition.
Mom. Tradition. It was hard on my mom. But I never really was like... I went to a youth group, I remember, in high school, because I really wanted to fuck this chick, Rachel.
A youth group?
Youth group, yeah.
These two youths.
Yeah. And who was, like, insanely hot, but she was, like, super, super into it. And I was super into her. And then I was like, whatever, I'll play basketball with some Christian kids for a minute.
Talk about God.
Yeah. Like, I fucking love God so much.
Yeah. And then
they fucking baby, I love
then
God.
Then you let them know deep down inside, I was baptized Orthodox. They'd be like, oh, we got to save you. We got to save you from that old church.
I'm here. Save me. Yeah.
You know, speaking of Orthodoxy, you know, in Greece, they just have like these old Byzantine churches from like the times of Constantine, like these original Orthodox churches. Wow. And they're so fucking old, and whatever, everything in Greece is old as shit.
Yeah.
They just like build these. So there's like, I swear to God, the church is like maybe the size of your apartment. Mm-hmm. And they just build like whole hotels like over and around them. They're like,
that's fucking so disrespectful.
And like,
the whole church is the size of the apartment?
Yeah. Wow. It's like, they have like, because they were built in like the year, whatever, 1000 or something.
Yeah, yeah,
you know, they're old as shit.
Wow.
So cool. And there's like so many of them. And then like certain parts of Athens, they had, it was actually like,
They have all these stores where you buy like your Orthodox like golden gilded shit.
Hell yeah.
And I was like, going, I was like, man, maybe I should grab like something real tacky from one of these places for Eric. And I walked inside one. I was like, everything is like $500 minimum.
Yes.
I was like, this shit is all real deal. But we like woke up one morning early, like around 7 o'clock in the morning, and there's like the monks in the church at the end of the street, just like singing like the wake up. Like him, like that. Remember that 60 Minutes we watched?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
With those fucking Sigma males.
Yeah, those guys who just like live on an island, no women are allowed. Yeah.
Hell yeah.
What is that?
It's like they harmonize.
Is that Wham?
Yeah, yeah. Wake me up before you go. Don't leave me hanging on like a yo yo. And then they like, then they bring the church bells.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
you know, in another life, I could picture myself like harmonizing with the boys like all day in a church. I would have the best voice.
I believe it.
Yeah,
I bet you do. I bet you sing alone all the time. I do. It's a secret.
I can't sing for shit.
It's my secret.
I don't even.
That's my secret hobby.
What do you sing?
Yeah. Where or what?
What do you sing?
Do you sing Jerry Reed?
I like to sing Leonard Cohen. I like to sing things like that.
Mm.
Some folk stuff. I grew up with my dad singing folk music to us, like playing the guitar for us in the living room. We would kind of gather for that.
Talk about Jesus?
No, it was more like Cat Stevens.
I just have trouble reconciling that whole counterculture and the Jehovah's thing. The Jehovah.
What do you mean?
I don't know. They just seem like counterintuitive to me. You know, I think like the counterculture seems like anti-establishment, anti-church, anti-kind of whatever. But I guess also
of that religion.
No, well, of any.
Okay. It seems anti-church.
Yeah.
In the Bible, you mean?
Well, anti-establishment, and I would view the any church as a type of establishment.
I think that the Bible is, if it were followed more closely, religions wouldn't look the way they did. So, you know, the Jehovah's Witnesses have this sort of like drab look to everything of theirs. It looks this, like this bureaucratic, sort of oppressive look to their churches. They're called kingdom halls, not churches. So they really look, yeah, very bureaucratic, very much like the DMV in the mood and like purposeful atmosphere.
Well, that makes sense because their headquarters
rough.
Is
in... It's rough, that's bleak, but it's
Brooklyn,
it's
yeah.
True.
You ever been to the Watchtower? Wait,
why? I have, yeah.
Why? Why does it look that way?
Well, because it's sort of ostentatious. Well, I could think of several reasons. It's ostentatious to do these showy displays and create idols of God that you worship. Literally all over the Bible.
Yeah.
Everywhere you look in the Bible, you're not supposed to do that. So
you're about to convert me. Yeah.
So it's like, so
then
it's,
you look at the Orthodox
you
church.
Know, everybody's a little
boy, drip.
Everybody's got a little hook. You know, everybody's got a hook. So you know, you can't. Everyone's a little right, and you know,
the Orthodox. There's a point super, when you, they're super drippy, but they believe in the same shit. No,
it's also the original form.
Well, no, they also believe in the Holy Ghost. So the Jehovah's Witnesses do not believe in the Holy Trinity. And they don't celebrate the holidays because they were all just stolen from pagans and other religions. And it's a no-brainer. We know these things are facts. Mm-hmm. So they don't celebrate these holidays for that reason. And everyone thinks, how weird that you guys don't celebrate holidays. What a bunch of weirdos.
Christmas?
You think you're better than us?
Yeah. It's
like, well, why do you go to a Christian church and celebrate a pagan holiday? It makes no sense. So, and like celebrate a pagan god. It doesn't make any sense. So they, you know, they're very, like literal with a lot of the things in the Bible. And it's like, I think that's one of the reasons why it becomes so easy to, to convince people in a logical way that that's, you know, like through logic and reasoning that would be like the most,
the Ben Shapiro
the most,
tactic.
The most yes. Realistic
crush them with logic
of
yes.
Choices.
Yeah.
So it's like, all right, well, you're not mentioning a lot of other things that you do.
Yeah.
Like, so, I mean,
Have the
I'm not here. It's not my purpose to like.
Have they ever
to disavow
up?
The Jehovah's Witnesses or to make them feel like somehow like that they've got it wrong?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's wrong for me. Like that's.
That's
not. That's all I know.
Yeah, that's not.
I don't know anything else.
Have they ever really fucked up? Have they ever, like, because the Catholics, like, they're like, fuck kids, you know. The,
of course they do.
The
of course
other
they do. Of course
people,
they cover it up. All religions cover that up. All religions cover that up.
Yeah.
So they actively cover it up. And there have been, like.
Some control the media.
Yeah. There have been.
Control the banks.
Of course. I don't even want to know where this is going.
No topic.
All right, let's try these cards here. On the we're taking our freedom away here. We don't deserve this freedom anymore.
We don't deserve this freedom. It ain't free.
Hey, yeah. According to Anheuser-Busch, let freedom ring, baby.
Read them and weep. Oh, man.
So these cards were...
How do you stay informed and why do you choose those sources?
Oh, I love that question.
Wow, that's an interesting one.
Yeah, take okay.
Well, we really didn't get away from this topic.
That really didn't I take us anywhere new.
Because it's the Bible. It's the word of our Lord. Let's go.
Sure.
Do okay. I have to answer the same question or do I pick a new card?
That's up to you, but typically we pick a new one.
We should... Let, would you
I think if, in the rules of the card
so
game...
So I can't cheat.
In the rules of the card
so my
game...
my answers are candid.
That I read in that deck... you know, you're all supposed to answer the thing, and then whoever has the best answer gets to keep the card. But I'm not playing it that way. I don't really.
I can
care.
Answer this question. I'll tell you right now.
If you'd like, sure.
Breitbart.
Yeah.
Next.
That's
sure.
Yeah, yeah. It says and why.
And how?
It says and why do you choose those sources?
Oh, and why? Because it's the truth.
Yeah. All right. Very good. I'm satisfied. All right, next one. Name things, three things you're grateful for and why. My Harley Davidson.
Ooh, good.
My Triumph.
Let's talk a little about that.
And my hot fiance. All right, cool.
Nice.
Beautiful. three things I'm grateful for and why. I'm sorry, were you going to say something?
Well, I wanted to talk a little more about the bikes. You're wearing a motorcycle shirt. You said you're Harley.
Oh, yes.
Let's hear what you got.
Well, I have a Harley Davidson Lowrider S.
Lowrider S?
Yes, it's a monoshock suspension midsize Harley platform motorcycle.
Okay.
So midsize Harley means like a big bike for any other company that makes motorcycles.
Okay.
But there's still a bigger Harley.
That's the one I rode on, right?
Yeah, yeah, we did ride it.
I smelled your hair the whole way.
Yeah,
you guys let him ride on your bike?
Yeah, he rode on my
before me.
We had like maybe six beers, and we were bar hopping.
Hell yeah! That's what's up.
I was like, oh yeah, jump
I'm not
on.
Gonna make you walk.
And I was like, Sam never lets me show her how fast it goes. You want to see how fast it goes? He's like, yeah, I want to see how fast it goes.
Hell
I was
yeah.
Like, cool.
I'm really concerned about this. That's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
And about 3 minutes, we were at the Bob Inn.
Did he wear your helmet or what?
Yeah, he wore my helmet.
Oh, yeah,
I was helmetless. Yeah,
that's a gentleman. That's a gentleman's
yeah.
Road. Yeah,
you know, I had to take care of my riders.
My riders.
You could have gone a different route with that. thanks for the respect.
Okay.
Well, no, it's like because we went to some. I met them at the Whistler or something, and there was like a bunch of 14-year-olds hanging out there, and then nobody wanted to be there anymore, and. I was like, okay. And I tried to go inside to meet them, and they were like, oh, no, sorry, there's a line. And I was like, fuck that. I'm
not
taking a line in Logan Square.
No.
So I went to the bar next door, and they charged me. I ordered a rocks pour of fucking whatever, four roses. And they charged me, I think, like, on the check, it was like fucking $16 for a rocks pour of four roses. I was like, dude, I could buy a whole bottle of Mariano's for $19. Get the fuck out of here.
That's a great thing to say to a bartender. I could go to a grocery store and get more.
Well, I didn't say that. That was my thought. But I like looked at her and I like looked at the check and it was like it was weird because it was labeled all fucked up on the menu. It said like a rock. It said on the rocks. And then it listed four roses and it was like $9 or $10. I was like, okay, that's fine. Whatever. I'll pay $10 for a rocks pour real quick. But then they hit me with the credit card processing charge, which you know I'll pass on that. I'm not taking an argument on that. I get it.
Mm-hmm.
But
they charge me, then they charge me for more, even though it was listed as a rocks pour on the menu, but then they charge me additional more than it was listed for on the menu.
You told me about this shit.
Yeah. And it's just like, you know, and I know a lot of places charge additional for a rocks pour. That makes sense because it's whatever, fucking 1.5 as opposed to 1 ounce, blah, blah, blah. But it just seemed deceptive to me generally. And also it's like, yo, I'm not paying fucking $14 or $15 for one drink at some shit bar in Logan Square. I'm sorry. So
did you go full Karen? Did you throw your bar stool?
I thought about it, but I asked, I was like, what's this about? You know, it says on the menu it's a different price. And she's like, oh, let me get my manager. I was like, you know what? Fuck it. Here's your money. I paid cash. I was like, here's a $2 tip for the drink. Thank you so much. I'm just never going to come back here. Because that's what a reasonable person will do.
Right.
Yeah.
And then I said, get on the back of my bike, Adam. We're going for a ride.
That's true.
That's fucking sick.
It was really beautiful. I wrote a poem about it.
I'm fucking sure you did, Adam.
Yeah. I was going to be like, did you really? But I don't question it.
I hope somebody destroys that poem after you die.
And then we went to the Bob Inn, we ordered some Telemordu, and it was cash only, and it was like $5 a pour. And I was like, all right, I'm all about this life.
Respect.
I think we did like a four top with a ribeye with cash sales that night, so I was feeling flush.
Yes, those are always good nights.
Did you end up going out Saturday night?
This past Saturday?
Yeah.
Yeah, I picked up Sam. She was like wandering down California with some friend of hers from high school that lived in New York for a while. Now she lives here.
She was wandering.
Well, they were going to go to Taco Bell. Yo, get this.
Just found
it. Get this. Yeah. I like call her up. I'm like, where are you at? She's like, well, we just tried to go to Taco Bell and they told us it would be an hour wait. I was like, yo.
Good for Taco Bell.
There's an hour. There's an hour wait.
Also, get your shit together.
For a table at Taco Bell it's right now?
Yeah. They're pretty intense at night. If it's that cantina one.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. They see some shit. They're in the trenches over there. That is...
I was at a cantina last night, actually.
Yeah?
And service was quick and snappy. I went there after going to Nobu.
How's Nobu?
I'll let Ian finish. Also, a question about the rules. Forgive me, a formatting question.
Hmm?
Can we alternate answering first? Because I have time to think about this, and I want my answers to be
off fast?
The cuff. Yeah.
Yeah,
sure. Oh, yeah.
Just throw them down, too, because this is nobody's going to judge us.
Oh, okay, fine.
I mean, that's not true.
No, fucking judge us. What's the fun? What's the fun in no judgment?
They had better judge. They had better.
Anyway, so
she's like, oh, we tried to go to fucking Taco Bell, and there was an hour wait to get into Taco Bell. So I pick her up, and I just took her to Corner Bar, her and her friend to Corner Bar, and then her friend was telling me about how she dated some fucking bartender in New York, and they're divorced now, and she works in fashion, and they lived in fucking Greenpoint, you know, same old story that we've all heard 1,000 times. And
bartenders, Greenpoint.
Yeah, bartenders, yeah. Greenpoint, fashion,
relationship, and
wholesale buyer, you know, whatever. And then she dipped out, and I drank about like 6 ounces of Fernet, and then
I drank with Huebner until 5 a.m. on Saturday.
What's a Huebner?
Michael Huebner, Iron Mike Huebner. He's our beverage specialist.
Does that just mean alcoholic friend?
Not, no.
Yes, yes,
not
no.
Exactly, yes.
Yes. He's a very talented, like, a mixologist is a stupid term, but he's a very talented bartender and bar operator. Sure. And
knows his shit, knowledgeable, talented, cool. Just like all around nice person.
Yeah. Good dude.
Somebody, at the table. Somebody everyone should know.
So far we've got 8 on that table. That's pretty good, guys. I like seeing that. That's good.
Dude, we're going to finish all of them.
Yeah, I like seeing that. Cool.
Well, I couldn't fit them in the fridge, so we got to make space.
Sure.
Yeah. Someone. Wait. Are there some in the freezer that I need to roast?
No. They're all in the fridge.
Okay.
Yeah. I tried to put the whole box in there, but the dimension. You got like a Brooklyn size.
Yeah, it's a small one.
Yeah.
That's a one person fridge for sure.
I feel a little bit like I'm back on the East Coast in this apartment. It's fucking refreshing.
That's nice. I like hearing that.
Yeah.
Except it's still bigger.
No, it's still bigger. Yeah. It's still bigger. It's still nicer. But yeah.
Thanks for
that. We got all retarded. I'm going to really quickly name 3 things that I'm grateful for, and I'm going to tell you why. I'm grateful to be 6'3" tall.
It's pretty cool.
because none of it's, I just like being tall. I like being larger than other people.
Yeah. I think
I enjoy being imposing, you know, like at any time.
That's pretty.
If I decide.
A rare treat.
There could be a real issue here.
Yeah. Do you get to make the decisions in groups more often than others?
100%. No. Second thing, I'm grateful to have so few strings in my life that I can just selfishly focus purely on whatever I'm doing in that moment. I don't have a wife, I don't have kids, I don't have anything like that. I spent my entire 20s just like really focusing on cooking and becoming the best I could be at that. And I'm really happy with where I am in terms of that space. I feel like there's control and direction and it's good. I'm pretty thrilled about that. And that's another like non-material thing.
Yeah.
Like me being tall, that's technically a material thing.
Sure.
Kinda. Mm-hmm. But it's not like...
So you've got no strings to hold you down to make you fret or make you frown?
No frowns here until, you know, whatever.
Well, you had strings, I'm sure. But now you see there are no strings on you.
Yeah. I mean, my strings are like my restaurant, you know? And it's like, I own the restaurant, but the restaurant kind of like owns me really more so. And that's like, you're always wrestling. You're always wrestling with this thing, trying to tame it, trying to make it work for you and not for you to work for it.
Mm-hmm.
My third thing that I'm grateful for and why is my mother, because she's awesome, amazing person.
I was waiting for her to come up.
Yeah. Had to deal with me, you know, so, and
you're first on the next one.
I'm first on the next one. I can't fucking talk for this long.
You're doing a great job. Oh, yeah, we can take a break, too.
Off the cuff.
I forgot about that. We typically take a break about halfway through. We'll switch after that, Ian, for your close-up.
What is something you pretend to know about and why?
Any subject on any given day, all the time.
That's very rude of you to say. What is something I pretend to know about and why? What is something I pretend to know about and why? What do I pretend to know about? Hold on a second. Pretend. What am I pretending?
I pretend I know.
Well, they could also be joking.
I pretend I know how to paint.
Pretend could be joke.
Thank you for that. You just gave me an out.
Yeah. Pretend could be joke. That's what I said when I said. Yeah.
But still. What do I really pretend to know about?
It's hard to name one thing because I feel like you, off the cuff, can like jump on any topic and be like, oh yeah, this is the way that.
Yes, ending is one thing, but like what are like I'm listening to things I know about in my head right now that I know how to talk about and.
Mm-hmm.
But what don't I know about that I pretend to know about? That's a fucking tough one, dude.
No, you're overthinking it for sure.
I pretend to know how to dress.
You're doing all right.
I don't know.
Given the circumstances, you know.
Don't know how to dress.
Where'd you get that shirt, speaking of
I this particular shirt, I got it from a manufacturer in Taiwan called Sunrise Incorporated.
That's cool.
Very high end.
Yeah,
very luxury.
$8. It cost $8. Shipping cost $8. The actual shirt cost $4,200. They use the same textile factory as Versace and Gucci.
Oh, okay.
I can't tell which part is real and which part is made up.
That's my pretend question.
Got it. All right, let's take that break, guys. I think that's a nice place to do it.
You gonna press pause?
Yeah.
No, fuck it. Record the break. Hey, what's up? We're breaking.
What's the sweet spot? What do you think? What's the best part of doing this?
Of doing this part?
Yeah.
I don't know. Seeing how gold dry and then kind of dressing them up with the sauce. That's my favorite part.
I
I like the eating part.
Yeah, that part's good too. Yeah.
I like the making money part. My Russian-Ukrainian over here. My Russian-Ukrainian friend says over here.
Okay. And we're back, in a way.
We're going to talk about the Hunter Biden laptop.
The real question is, how many beers can we drink before the painting's done?
All of them. Oh, I bet
I
you
it's
we
possible.
Can
I think
we came with 24. We're about 12 in.
I'm on one of those.
Is it so time? Should I flip it?
Yeah, sure. We've started. Okay.
Who's someone from your childhood who shaped you, who shaped who you are today and why?
Oh, your mom, right? I wanted to bring it up, but you can say whatever. I don't want to talk about her soon because I know that that's a good.
My mom, yeah. My mom shaped me. She made me, you know.
Right.
And it was definitely like
she physically shaped you.
She physically shaped me with her her body and her genes.
They were that tight.
Her whole organism. There
she was. She
just
wore,
fucking.
Her mom genes were that tight.
I love it. Someone who shaped who I am today and why. There was a guy named Yukio Utada Kancho, sensei, then Kancho, in a Yoshinkan Aikido dojo, and my dad made sure that I did some kind of martial art when I was a kid, did a couple different ones. I was between the ages of between 8 and 14, I did that martial art for. And there was you walk in the dojo, there's a rhythm to things, there's a hierarchy, there's respect, discipline, all of these things.
Mm-hmm.
People are ranked by a belt. People think, you know, the color of your belt is how much of a badass you are, typically. It's not the case. There's a function in a dojo with that. It's people you have the opportunity to learn from. And people who you ultimately will listen to, and people who will ultimately fuck you up if you if you mess with them. And Yukio Tada had, when I look back, like a lasting impact on my development because he was like a non-parent kind of person, kind of coach.
Where was this?
This was in the Philadelphia area. It was a Yoshinkan Aikido dojo.
Cool.
Out there, and and I learned how to grapple, and I learned I learned a lot of things. A lot of things was also just like respecting routines and respecting taking care of the place. Like I remember, sure, like techniques and tests and all these things, but I also remember like the garden, taking care of the garden, and I remember washing the mats, and I remember washing the showers, and like what, like maintaining the place,
yeah,
and showing respect to everybody. And
how many days a week were you there?
I was there initially once a week on Sundays.
Uh-huh.
And then we would do night classes sometimes. We would do day classes when I like didn't have school because I was a child, you know, I was in school.
Mm-hmm.
And but always on weekends. And then towards the end, much more, like towards the end. But I don't know what happened, but there was a break between my father and the association and like the organization.
Mm-hmm.
There was some sort of thing. I don't know any of the details. He never told me any of the details. And we stopped going altogether. And he stopped practicing Aikido. But he was like a black belt in Kenpo Karate. He did Taekwondo as a kid. Yeah, anyway, Yukio Utada, fucking absolute G. He's still out there. He's still doing his shit.
Cool.
Yeah.
I have martial arts in my family.
Oh, yeah?
My brother-in-law he's had several gyms, like several martial arts gyms. And my sister has been involved in that, too.
Martial arts gyms.
Since like, I was in high school, like well, like mixed martial arts gyms. Like,
mixed so, martial arts. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, they started out. He never went taekwondo. He was always jiu-jitsu and sort of like whatever route that is. I can't pretend to know what it, how that language goes, but. He's always been on that side of things. He never went the Taekwondo route. I remember he always made a specific sort of like a, there was a hesitation to sort of align himself with that. And, yeah, he's always done that. So they started dating when I was in high school and he started to teach me a few things about martial arts around that time. I would ditch classes, I would have study hall, so
yeah.
I would get a pass or I would forge one to go up to the library, and then I would just sneak off campus and go up to the head shop up the street that he was working at and like as a body piercer at too.
Get the fuck.
And he would teach me martial arts and then
shop,
talk about
piercing.
Philosophy and that's how I would ditch high school stuff to go and learn about
way
philosophy.
You'll learn way more in that
so
place
good.
Than in high school.
Yeah, it was so good.
About how to be a real man.
Yeah. So.
Or you'd be sitting in class learning about the Electoral College.
Yeah.
Electoral College, yeah. You learn
then
about
you, and then you grow up and be like, man, this system's rigged. You'd be like, nah, it's just the way it is.
Yeah, yeah this is how.
Yeah. Or you could be a real warrior poet type and fucking know how to fuck somebody up.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Hell yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And I can steal wallets and all sorts of things.
You can steal wallets and get away with it, yeah.
What are you going to do?
Yeah.
The head shop when I was that age was like such a fucking it was so alluring.
Well, I wouldn't smoke.
It was
weed.
Like going
I wouldn't
to
go up there and smoke weed. I wouldn't like, go up there and get high. I would learn about that stuff. It's like I wouldn't. We wouldn't do that.
That environment though feels risque. Also in that time too, when like weed
right.
was like not cool.
Yeah,
weed is like.
We used to go to this. There's one head shop in the west suburbs called Roxy's, and behind Roxy's was a fucking brothel. So there was like. The neon lights and whatever, and it's like we would never could get in there, obviously. It's like not that we tried, it was shady as fuck, but I remember it was on North Avenue, and then we'd go into Roxy's, and when you could get in as soon as you turned 16, you couldn't go in if you were under 16. So
that's
then,
so fucking awesome.
And then we'd go in there, and then we like whatever, look around at the pipes, and like you know, they about like a little mini bong, you know. Like,
I'm sorry, I thought you meant the brothel.
Oh, no,
you
no,
get
no,
into
no.
the brothel when you're 16.
No.
Wow, there's been some worlds, yeah.
We could not get into the brothel, but it was clearly a brothel. And I remember we go in there, and then there was a, you know, all of a sudden in gym class, there's like this teacher's assistant or like this guy's whatever, doing his rounds. He's not tenured or anything. Just came on board, and he's like assistant coach and some shit, and he's like, you know, doing PE. And I forget what the fuck his name was, Mr. D or something. And all of a sudden, I go back to one of my classes one day in BD, and like one of the BD kids is like, yo, I went to Roxy's last night. Fucking Mr. D was working the counter. I was like, shut the fuck up.
BD coach?
When I was in one of my BD classes, my behavioral disorder classes. So that was a troubled youth. We didn't have alternatives. Our school was so big, we didn't have to go to alternative school unless you were like, you know, real crazy.
I went to alternatives. So, that's why Ian and I like each other.
Yeah. They kept it in-house, you know.
Yeah. That means you're a fucking cool guy.
Because if they send you to alternative school, the school district actually has to pay money to a private institution for you to go there.
Yeah, because they want you to get the fuck out of there.
They want you to get the fuck out. But because we were such a big unit school district... It was like it was viewed upon by the school board as a poor use of funds when we had so many resources at our disposal. So they isolated us in like one hallway of
you
the school.
You had like 6,000 kids in your school, like 16.
Some fucking 000. Ridiculous amount. Yeah. There was like I think like 1,400 or 1,700 kids in my graduating class. Like just like a massive amount. So I mean, yeah, multiply that by four, and they get bigger every year. So.
Wow.
But, yeah, so we're like, oh, so then all of a sudden, we're like, oh, shut the fuck up. So we go up there one night and fucking go in there and I go to buy a bong. It's like, there he is, fucking Mr. D. And I just remember looking at him and be like, what's going on? I was like, I'm going to buy this bong right here. And he's like, don't fucking tell anybody I work here.
I love that so much.
I was like, deal.
Like, hey, by the way, I just want to let you know right now, you're the fucking man.
Deal.
I fucking love you, and you're the fucking man.
Shit. That shit was wild.
Yeah. It never came up again?
I don't remember. He didn't last very long there. I'm sure it came out that he was fucking working over there. I was like...
And like moonlighting.
I mean, but the thing was, is like, I didn't get along with the administration when I went to school. Like, I was in like all these extracurricular clubs that I was excelled in. Like, I was in a woodworking club called Skills USA, and I placed, and they have statewide competitions. And it was, there was two high schools every year that would send 14 qualifiers in the whole state, would participate in the woodworking competition. And you just had to pass a written exam to get in. And so like, I would nail it every year from fucking sophomore, junior, and senior year. And York would send like four or five kids, and then Oswego High School would send like the remainder. And then maybe there was like one off from some other random high school in the state. And every year I wouldn't get to go because I would get some ticket for smoking cigarettes in the park or some bullshit over the summer, and they'd be like, oh, you're suspended from this.
What the fuck are you talking about?
You get a. I was in clubs, and I would get along with the administration because I would get a. I would get a ticket in off school hours. So, and they'd be like, if you're in a competitive club, you have to participate by IHSA regulations, which is Illinois High School Sports Association.
Okay.
So if you're in a sport and you get into trouble, then you know whatever out of school, then you. You're suspended for a third of a season or the whole season, depending on what the offense is. So if you go to a party, it's meant to discourage kids from going to fucking parties and shit.
I see.
And if you get tickets, you know, then
gay.
Yeah, it's real stupid. So,
but you get a ticket for smoking a cigarette?
No, we'd be like hanging out in Wilder in the park in Elmhurst and be like, you know, just like all me and all my friends would just stand around a car smoking,
being cool guys,
just
yeah.
fucking smoking cigarettes,
get and a ticket like for being a cool guy,
and then a cop would roll up and be like. Like, murr, murr. And then, like, write us all tickets on the spot, confiscate our cigarettes, and then, like, dip out. And
get
then,
the fuck out of here.
No, this is the fucked up thing. So,
go raid a crackdown.
You do something.
Pussy. Yeah.
Right. Fuck. Yeah. They write us all tickets, and then they give the information over to the school. And it's interesting because the Chicago Tribune actually recently wrote an expose about this in the state of Illinois, how local school districts use police departments to enforce truancy when it's actually against the law in the state of Illinois. So they utilize police departments and weaponize them to essentially financially punish students as opposed to punish them and try to educate them. Mm-hmm. Anyway, moral of the story is, me and the administration at the school were not on the same wavelength, even though I qualified for statewide woodworking competitions and statewide cooking competitions.
But those aren't sports.
They're not sports. I was never allowed to compete because I had tickets. But the difference is, if you're in cross country or you play tennis or you play football, and you're suspended for a third of a season, well, that's like 3-4 games because you have one or two events every week. Uh-huh. My whole activity is a singular event, a singular competition that I'm not allowed to participate in.
So you always wanted to cook.
I work with my hands, I think.
Got it. Yeah, that makes sense.
For me, the academic stuff, you know, whatever. I like to read about politics and shit like that. But mm-hmm. I was not one for academia. Yeah. I did not find it rewarding. I liked being educated, but I didn't feel like I had to, like, why do I have to fucking explain myself to a bunch of people that ultimately aren't going to give a shit what I have to say at the end of the day anyway? Seem kind of pointless. Whereas, like, if I work with my hands,
may as well just stay in bed then.
Yeah, if I work with my hands and I build something or I paint something or I cook something, you know, I know what it is when I'm done with it, and there it is. The product is right there in front of me.
Yep.
You know, it's just so much more tangible.
I relate with that.
Yeah. So, needless to say, my discrepancies with the or my confrontations with the administration came to a head by the time I was a senior, and I realized that none of it mattered anyway, and I had all the credits I needed to graduate, and
get out of there.
I had managed to get myself like nominated to like the student advisory council because I had moved out of the B
BD classes. I was entirely a mainstream student. And I think, and which was like,
all this terminology is so fucking foreign to me. Yeah. Mainstream BD.
Yeah.
What is student advisory?
What do you, basically, it was like, this committee that I was nominated to by my peers and my instructors that was like, this kid has shown great improvement in whatever track that he was on. He came into high school, we all thought he was going to end up some fucking crackhead heroin addict, something or other. Troublemaker, criminal.
Success story.
And like now he's doing this, but like, you know, he got a ticket for smoking outside of school.
What is the function of this student advisory board? What do you do?
Well, it was supposed to be like a, like basically like a parlay between like the student body and like the administration. And so I had some teachers that agitated.
Oh God!
It's some political shit. They agitated me and put me on there, and I think I was on it. I was officially on it for all of 2 weeks. We didn't even have a meeting before. Like the administration was like, "Fuck you! You can't be on it." And I like
Too cool. Yeah.
Yeah. And I like. And I remember I showed up in the assistant principal's office, and I was like, "Hey, I qualified for this statewide competition. You should let me compete." The only way I could get around this whatever bullshit about the ticket or whatever is if I go and appeal to you. And they're like, we're not going to appeal to you. Now, I felt discriminated against. I was a poor student. I was trying to go to culinary school. I could have gotten, like, you know, whatever, $10,000 in scholarship money if I won this competition.
Yeah.
And they're like, no, you... And I said, you're fucking discriminating against me because I'm not wealthy. And they said, this is... No, absolutely not. And I said, no, you're fucking full of shit. And I got in his face. And I remember he, like, grabbed his name tag off his desk and, like,
how old were you?
16 or 17, I like threw it at the wall behind him and like dented his fucking drywall. I was like, you're not gonna let me participate? Get fucked, buddy.
Sup, bitch.
Just like got real hostile with him and then just walked out. And then like, and he couldn't do anything.
Yeah.
I was like, what is he gonna do?
Hell yeah.
Expel me?
I was about to go to my management office in my condo building and do something much like that. But I demonstrated restraint.
You know, it's like, what are you going to do? Oh, expel me? Oh, so your numbers are all fucked up, Mr. Administrator, so you go back to the state and you're not going to get as much money? Get the fuck out of here. I know your game.
The very outcome of your experience, like, in school is, like, a demonstration of, like, why you're not into, like, that whole academia kind of thing.
Yeah.
There's all this fucking fucked up political bullshit that mires you. It's not purely about, like, competence or like cognition or your abilities.
It's about like
how
doing
smart you are. It's doing what the fuck other people tell you to do
for the sake of doing it
and thanking them for it. Yeah. And it's just like that's I've always had a problem with that too. Very similar in that way.
Yeah.
And authority, I think,
for the sake of itself, is pretty tough to work around.
Becoming a chef, though, you go right back into that. Yeah. You don't realize it. You go right the fuck
but
back into that.
The difference is they're showing you something that you haven't. They're teaching you a skill set. You know,
they're teaching you a trade. Yeah, well, sure. They're also teaching you how to be in the world. Like it's more of a it's less of just it's not so isolated. There's a philosophy behind it too. You know, like it's really all that Anthony Bourdain shit is really stupid, but he talked about like ethos and shit like that, and there's some of that there.
You're not, you don't fanboy on him at all?
On Bourdain?
Yeah.
Oh, well, it's complicated. Do you want me to talk about it?
I mean, if you'd like to, I'm curious because I don't know much about him.
I think back in the day, like coming up as a cook, it was like, you know, what he talked about being a cook, you know, in Kitchen Confidential, which is like the book that like indoctrinates you into being a line cook.
Yeah. Indoctrinate is a very important word here that Ian used, and it is very much about indoctrination. He's good at romanticizing the life and the lifestyle and all of these things, but the reality of it isn't as cool like as his prose makes it sound.
Sure.
It's not remotely as cool as that. His show, No Reservations, after Kitchen Confidential,
and he wrote
Cook's Tour, The Layover, or the whatever it was called. After his sort of book came out, romanticizing what the industry was, yada yada, No Reservations comes out, and suddenly everyone thinks that like they associate one piece of work with another piece of work, and a generation of people associated like being a chef with like traveling and eating.
Funny.
Eating boar intestine in the Sahara or whatever the fuck. Sure. Like, yeah. That's not what the fuck it is.
Yeah. Okay, so
same thing with Food Network 2. It's like, you there's, I don't know, people have a certain expectation when they enter something, and it turns out to be different, whether that be positive or negative. I think Bourdain sold a rosy image of what the industry is to a generation of people who didn't know any better. And I'm one of those people. So do I think he's a, like, this ultimate hospitality industry, restaurant industry god person? I feel like he's perceived that way, or like marketed that way. Mm-hmm. Just think he's another guy who's really good at talking, really.
Sure.
Yeah. And there's so many of those guys.
Almost a better writer than he was.
How are you doing? You know
what I mean? I don't hate that guy.
How are you doing at becoming that guy? Do you want to be that guy that is good at talking? Seem like you're doing all right.
To like become
just generally walking this earth and talking.
Me being good at talking?
Yeah.
I think I have a long way to go.
That's a good attitude.
Yeah, I think I have a long way to go. And I also don't think that's ultimately my goal, to be like good at talking.
No.
My
good goal, communicator.
Yeah, my goal, communication and talking are like fucking, they're similar but different. Yeah. Right. I think I'm an awesome communicator. Like I can.
You would have to be in your industry.
Yeah, really deliberate.
You couldn't be bad at communicating and see any kind of success. From what I would assume. So it's like furniture movers. Everybody, it only lasts about 2 weeks, you know, if they were bad communicators.
Yeah.
They would all have injuries immediately.
Yeah, no, that's true. But just like relaying information and making sure it's received and like mm-hmm. registered and understood and retained. Like, yeah, that's whatever you communicate. But like talking mm-hmm. as like an art form, I'm not really interested in that.
Name one thing that makes you nervous or uncomfortable and explain why.
Who is this one for?
Oh, that's so many things for you, Ian. Yeah. You have a...
yeah. Nervous and uncomfortable?
Yeah, nervous and uncomfortable. Or it was nervous or uncomfortable. Okay. Waking up in the morning. Okay. Next question.
Why?
I just think about all the stuff I have to do that day, and I'm like, ah, I just want to sleep for another 40 minutes.
Yeah. Does your heart race when you wake up sometimes?
Yeah, all the time.
Like,
yeah.
like Krusty the Clown
day.
Like that?
Yeah. Every day.
That sounded like Krusty the Clown a lot.
Okay, I'm going to read it. I'm going to answer it. Even if it's impossible to answer.
Sure. What about me, guys? I want to answer some questions. Gosh.
You want one? You get the next one.
Okay.
You got this one.
Well, it's too late now.
I haven't read it.
I can't guilt trip.
Have I committed?
Yeah, you're committed.
Blank always makes me laugh because blank. blank always... Trump always makes me laugh because he's retarded.
Very good.
He's pretty good.
All right, Adam, ready?
Ready.
What are you willing to fight for and why?
Oh, this has come up 2 times on the show.
Fuck yeah, dude. We gonna fuck up.
What am I willing
to fight for? I know who we're fucking up.
What am I willing to fight for? Nothing that's not willing to fight for me.
All right, acceptable. Love it. All right, I'm next. What's one thing you would change about the way you were raised? Not being so fucking poor.
Done. Let's build some momentum here.
I think that could be said for probably everybody in the room.
Yeah. some money would have been
poor. We were so poor. Oh my god.
What does a life well lived mean to you?
I had
Maserati, Ferrari. Lamborghini.
It's my fucking turn to answer the question.
Oh, sorry.
A life well lived. What does it mean to be what does a well lived life mean to me? Learning a lot, learning as much as you can, being as developed in as many different areas as you can.
Mm-hmm.
Be taking care of the people you care about. First of all, finding the fucking people you care about, people worth caring about.
That's a good one.
Then taking care of them. Then if you have the opportunity to fucking teach somebody what you've learned, what you fought to learn, passing that on and And then fucking dying. Yeah, and then letting the cycle repeat.
That'll be the fun part.
What about Spawn?
Spawn?
Like what about Spawn?
Like the comic book character?
Or about having a child?
Yeah, don't you need like
the one from hell, the comic book character
from
hell?
Extend the DNA or something like that?
Oh, that's an option.
What is guaranteed to bring you happiness, Adam?
Guaranteed to bring me happiness?
Pussy.
No.
It's his turn to answer the question.
I'm sorry.
That is not guaranteed to bring me happiness. That's guaranteed to bring me strife.
Hell yeah.
But,
hashtag manosphere.
Frozen 4-0s.
I mean, self-created, you know, for the most part.
Yeah.
But I think painting people from life, this is the perfect kind of stress to where it allows me to focus on how stressed I feel in the act and not focus so much on how stressed I feel about all the other things.
Yeah.
It's kind of a nice little...
Do you wake up with your heart beating through your chest ever?
Yeah. Yeah, I do.
You ever wake up
very
with
anxious,
fucking heart's
I'm
racing?
I'm a very anxious person. I really am. Yeah. So running helps me with that too. I think I need to put myself into these high stress situations because I'm so used to feeling this intense anxiety and... you know, that translates.
That's like your emotional cardio.
Yeah. So that translates in the
it's
form
like
of just walking down the street and having racing thoughts that might be negative to where it's like I'm trying to keep myself ramped up in this like fight or flight mode where I'm getting this release of cortisol. And for some reason, that's my default. So I'm doing actions like this and like running and things like that are like, okay, I'm sort of overriding that system and doing something like positive with that. It's a good trade or a good, I don't know if it's really a trade, but it's a good redirection of that.
Do you think about your environmental footprint? Why or why not? This is my question.
I don't know what that means. Like if I'm going to be tracked by someone, what do you mean?
I think you're supposed to think about your carbon output. Well, so I used to think about it a lot, you know, like I remember when I first moved to my first apartment, I was like, we don't run the AC during the day because nobody's here. We keep it off. You know, we fucking separate all the cans. We rinse them out and fucking, you know, do all this shit. And then I realized it doesn't fucking matter. It doesn't.
I mean,
I think about my environment these days. I think about my environmental footprint like this. If it's more economically effective to be low carbon, then I'll be low carbon. I'll ride motorcycles all day. I'll make modifications so they burn more fuel all day. But at the end of the day, that motorcycle's going to burn less fuel overall to move me than my vehicle will, than a car will. Even if it's, you know, a CRV with a four banger in it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like the thing doesn't really use that much gas. But I'd also say this, you know, gas is expensive. Maybe I'll put some solar panels on the roof, buy an electric car. You know, fucking, I don't know. Who knows? But is that really any less environmentally poisonous? I hear it costs a lot of pain and agony to harvest those batteries.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I don't know the math on it.
Oh, lithium or making the solar panels?
Yeah,
the batteries. And all manufacturing. It's all of it fucking.
But at the end of the day,
there's a trade-off, sure, but you're delaying the inevitable.
It'll probably cost me a lot less money on a daily basis if I'm going to spend, you know, next car. Hopefully, I got lots of money. You know, it'll cost me fucking 40-50 grand, and at which
it's
point,
not going to cost you 40-50 grand for a nice car. In what are you going to make this purchase? 3 years from now, it's going to cost you 120 grand.
Well, I'm sorry. Okay. Yeah, so
you know what a Ford F-150, a new one, costs? It's like a fucking $70,000 fucking truck, dude.
Yeah. So, wait, actually, you know what? No, I know the answer.
The value of the dollar, it's not.
I'm just saying.
Like, a Jaguar is going to cost you 200K.
Yeah, a fucking sedan or some shit, whatever. Hey, let's call it $100,000. Even if it costs me a fucking $100,000, I don't drive a vehicle that much.
That's a RAV4 Limited.
If I got fucking solar panels on the roof and I charge the fucking car, then it'll cost me basically nothing to drive it around every day.
I really like that idea. I know people who have done that. It's like worked out for them. And yeah, that's a cool kind of...
But apparently now is the time to buy solar panels because you still get subsidized by the government. And the tax incentives wear off over time. The more people buy panels, the less incentives there are left. And so right now they're a write-off, apparently. So
yeah, my parents have some. They just got them.
Apparently you can lease them, you can buy them. There's all sorts of ways you can do it.
I have a friend who sells them in Texas. I think that's how he makes his living.
Here comes... Do you identify with people who live with mental health conditions? Why? No. Because I have a perfect mind.
Fake news.
Next.
Adam! Have you ever experienced a language or cultural barrier? How did you work through it?
Two or three times. First time was when I was in the Caribbean. I was 24, I want to say, 23 or 24. And we were it was Antigua. We also stayed in Dominica in this village, which was
Bermuda.
An ex-girlfriend's
Bahamas.
Kind of stepfather figure. He grew up there, so he had his father there, so we got to stay in this village, in this place that had these 12-inch gaps in the ceiling where insects could just kind of crawl in, and it was like nothing. So staying there and going to this cultural event that the inhabitants had, the people who lived there, I don't know what you call it, that locals... Sure. There was this huge street festival and there was this band playing, and she was actually not white, my girlfriend at the time, she was Indian, and so I looked around, I was like the only white person in a sea of faces that were just not white, and it was just this sort of first time that I had ever experienced that. So everyone's dancing, everyone's singing. There's this reggae sort of band on the stage, and the guy's singing like, "Watch out for the midget, watch out for the midget." And there was this, I guess, this small person on stage, and this was the song, and everyone was just super into it. And that was like it was a funny memory, very easy to place it with that song.
What's the name of that artist?
I can't remember. I feel like you could look those lyrics up on
Google.
Watch
out for the midget?
Yeah.
You might be able to find it.
So that was just the strangest feeling. And it's like it didn't mean anything to anyone. I didn't feel a sense of danger about it. But it just still, that was kind of cool. That was the first time I'd experienced that, being a suburban kid, you know, in just like suburbs of Chicago. Kid.
Like, whoa, yeah, hey, yeah. Just a midget to all these people.
Yeah. Yeah, that was the most memorable part, yeah. No, I wound up eating organ meat that night, and it was just, what a cool memory. What a cool experience.
How old were you?
Like 24.
Okay, gotcha.
I mean, I had never been somewhere like that. I'd never been out of the country. I didn't know anything.
Have you ever had like organ meat or offal before 24?
I hadn't, no.
Gotcha. What'd you eat? Do you remember? Like heart, probably?
Liver, for sure. And it was like a street cart, you know, that had this organ meat as though it was... I don't know. What would we have on the street here? Like not
hot dogs.
Kind of hot dogs. Yeah,
yeah. In a way, tacos or something. Meat, yeah.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So yeah, that was a good one.
Keep getting these weird ones. What's something that triggers fear in you, and how does your body respond to fear?
That's so deep.
One time, me and my friends in high school got really fucking high and went to this old Civil War era graveyard in Oak Brook. And we like wandered around there about 11 o'clock at night. My buddy's like, "Yo, there's somebody down there. There's somebody down there. Don't you see him? Don't you see him? Let's get the fuck out of here." And everybody just started fucking running.
Was it guarded or?
No. Like he saw
a graveyard.
It sounds like Valley Forge. Yeah, Civil War era graveyard. It
was okay.
Like old ass graveyard. Everything's old and it's like kind of like secluded for this densely populated suburbs. It was like, you know, wooded area, whatever.
Yeah.
It was generally creepy.
Yeah.
And we were in there. It was like fucking midnight or later. And we were just running around.
It's fucking General Custer.
And we were like, yeah, you know, high as fuck. And we're like, fuck, we gotta get out of here. It's a ghost.
It's the ghost of the
General. How did I, how did I respond?
Scooby-Doo.
I freaked out and I ran.
Cool. It is some
Scooby-Doo shit.
So when things scare you, you run. Okay, let's move on.
Gunshots. Run.
Yeah. Good knife, job. Run towards me. Yeah.
Right. Try to disarm him. Or just run the other way. Yeah.
Imagine yourself in the future. What will your greatest life accomplishment be? Having a kid. Easy.
How are you going to do it?
I'm going to fuck a chicken. I'm going to come at her.
That's one way. There are at least 10 ways, you know.
Sorry, it's the truth, no?
How else does it happen?
I will never create anything.
Either you come inside or you come in a little test tube. You know?
I will never create anything more impressive in this fucking world other than another life. No matter how fucking.
You think so?
I 100% fucking know. So there will never be anything that just the organism, you know what I mean?
It's, yeah.
And I'm able to do that.
That's fair.
You know, and that's capability we all have, and that's a crazy fucking thing.
I won't hold you to it.
You won't hold me to it? You think, yeah, I'm not going to bust any bitches anytime soon?
Well, I mean, I think that, you know, you could, but I won't hold you to it. So, you know, if you don't wind up doing it, you don't have to feel bad.
Oh, no, it's not that I'll feel bad. I can do it until I die.
Yeah,
after,
yeah,
I'm dead, I won't feel, so.
Yeah, I know.
Functionally.
Fair enough.
Is there a difference between inclusion and belonging, Adam?
Belonging and inclusion?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I rarely feel a sense of belonging, but I have been included many times. I think that when you're, I would find a good example of not belonging in nightlife. So just because you're on a guest list doesn't mean that you're welcome. And I think that I've experienced that hundreds of times.
I think we all have.
And
nightlife, like clubbing specifically?
Yeah, clubbing or, you know, after hours parties and speakeasies, secret speakeasies that are after hours and all these sorts of things. LA was a great window into that, where it was sort of somebody saw something in me that they thought strengthened their brand, or that they could.
Oh yeah.
They could, you know, do something. They might be able to serve more people if I was allowed to go to this room.
You were wearing a Gucci t-shirt. There was nothing. They're like, you're my
guy. No, there was nothing like that. It's just being an artist kind of gets, it opens a lot of doors, and it's kind of like it breaks down walls pretty easily. And I think that's been a perk. That's one of the perks, I think, that's been kind of cool. But that was a lesson that took a long time to learn. I don't know that I've still fully learned it. Mm. But
wait, do you feel like you belonged or were included?
I was included, but I wasn't real inclusion either. So it was like a
transactional.
Yeah, I felt something like that.
They were letting you in because
they weren't paying me. I was paying for drinks. It's not like that, but it's just like, here, you can be on this list of people who's
deemed important.
Yeah, and allowed to skip this line and things like that. And you feel cool, and it's like, it does nothing. It's a complete illusion.
Yes.
And anytime you get close to the people who are running things like that, they make it pretty clear to you that it's not real. Like, it's not real inclusion.
People who are like actually important, you'll meet so fucking few of them in your life.
Yeah.
They have to decide for you to meet them.
Mm-hmm.
They'll just remain kind of in the periphery, kind of be invisible.
Yeah, I think so. Well,
and it's
maybe
people who are actually important actually have any kind of importance. I mean, whatever, importance is largely subjective, but
sure.
Like, you won't. they will present themselves to you when they choose to, if they choose to. And there's usually some degree of transaction in that interaction. So
that's fair.
Is it my turn? Or
it's technically my turn, but I don't like my questions. I'm going to pick another one. Is there anything too serious to be joked about? No.
In this room?
I don't think so. Not a chance.
I like your answer.
I like your answer. Not a fucking chance.
What foods remind you of home?
It's a good one.
I've gotten all these before. We must be at... I need to shuffle that deck or something.
I shuffled it during the break. I don't know what happened. Right. Reminds me of home. Home is hard to pin down for me.
Okay.
A lot of moving around. Mm-hmm. I'm not from this country. Home. To my youth, thinking back to my youth, I think about home. Any Russian home cooking. Any like Russian or Ukrainian or kind of like the dish plov, for instance. It's lamb and rice and carrots and cumin and beef stock. You fry and then braise the lamb. You can make it with beef too, and then you kind of use long grain rice and you peel off it or whatever. And then there's a dish called shurpa, lagman, chiburiyeki. There's like all these things.
Cool.
Fried meat pies, borscht.
Oh, I love those.
Yeah. Yeah, anything with a ton of fucking steamed cabbage.
When I first met Eric.
Caviar. You know.
When I first met Eric, we were like talking, whatever, we're shooting the shit in the kitchen. And I was like, yeah, I was thinking about going down to Banya. And he looks at me, he's like,
You know Banya?
You know Banya?
Nobody fucking knows about Banya.
He's like, yeah, I love Banya. You don't know Banya?
Nope.
It's a Russian and Turkish steam, typically.
Sauna, yeah. So, yeah, like, there's the dry sauna, which is Russian. Then there's the wet sauna, where there's running water inside the sauna room. Okay. Yeah. It's Turkish.
There's, like, eucalyptus steam bath sometimes, too.
Yeah, and they're, like, eucalyptus oil. They put it in the water, and then they throw it on the hot rocks.
Super good. Fun.
And you sit in a room that's, like, 200 degrees.
Uh-huh. It's like 125 degrees. It'll still kill you. It'll kill you.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes the thermometers will read. Sometimes the thermometers will read a little higher.
Yeah.
Depending on where they are in the room. But, and then there's like, it's like a tiered room. So like, you can sit higher and higher up on the benches. And obviously the higher you get in the room, the hotter it is.
Hotter, dry. It stings. The air will begin to sting your skin.
Yeah. Like if you move too quickly, like you'll start to feel like leg burns, you know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And, and you start dripping sweat, just dripping, just pouring out every pore in your body. And,
there's something called veniki. And it's birch branches, white birch branches.
Oh, okay. Do they beat you
soaked,
with them?
They take them, they tie them together, they soak them in like a 5-gallon bucket. It's literally just like 20 of these little branches.
Yeah.
And you tie the ends of them together, it forms a little handle. Mm-hmm. And then you soak the leaves. The leaves are typically dry. They're dry, they're like ship dry or whatever. You soak them in a 5-gallon bucket in the sauna, and then you just kind of like shake them and eventually strike them all over the person's body in the sauna. And it's really good for like circulation. It's good for your skin. And there's like, if you're into fucking S&M, there's like some gay S&M happening too. You know,
There's you walk out of Banya and you feel like a fucking movie star. You know, your pores are all perfect.
Cool.
You know, if you're any kind of hungover, inflamed, it's all been expelled from your body.
Are you gonna do this together?
We used to go actually
number of times,
in Brighton Beach and like down by Coney Island.
It's crazy. It's crazy how depleting it is, because after you exit the hot room, whichever hot room you choose, there's usually choices.
Yeah, wet or dry or whatever.
You do a cold plunge. So that either comes in the form of a shower where you pull this rope and you're dumped with ice water, or you jump into a small but deep
6-foot well. Basically.
Yeah. With ice in it, and it shuts your pores, and it's all your, whatever, your pores like cinch close. And it's just like good for like preventing any kind of like infection or anything like that. You know what I mean?
Because you feel like your pores open after bunion. Like they don't,
you sit in a communal area.
They take a very long time to close up naturally, so you have to shock your body. But the other thing is, too, is that you're hot. Like your body is like trying to push heat and sweat to the edges of your pores, you know, out of the center of your body. And then you jump in an ice-cold pool, and all of a sudden, it all comes back to the center. So it promotes the circulation in that way.
Okay.
And it's like a... It's a shocking thing, and you get out and you feel like you just snorted an Oxycontin or something, because you're just like you can't breathe.
It's really intense. Yeah, it fucks your breathing up. It's just like
but at the same time,
you know, it's also framed at like a fucking spa too.
Yeah,
and I feel like spas are like these houses of relaxation where you're being pampered and stuff like that. But like I kind of like that, like from my culture. What a spa is like taking your body to every extreme. And then you walk out and you feel better than you ever would going to like cow shed.
Yeah.
This was Soho House shit. You're like, oh, I wore a robe for 2 hours.
Yeah, no.
Somebody rubbed my feet.
You're exponentially more relaxed than you would be in any other situation.
Yeah.
And
you're exhausted. You like have to eat. You need like sustenance after that experience.
So I learned about Chubreki because I used to go to this Banya Chicago Sweat Lodge out at like Cicero in Milwaukee. And I went there for a number of years before I even moved to New York. And it was like a special occasion kind of thing. We did it in the wintertime here, because the wintertime here is brutal, you know. And so you go in the winter and then you get out of the sauna and they have this little fenced off backyard area. And you walk outside, you know, in your... in your robe or whatever, you know, when I'm naked. You just go out there and then you roll around in the snow a little bit. And but they had a little cafeteria there and they were like, oh, then they had this delicacy. Chubreki, which is like a Ukrainian hot pocket, essentially. It's like a laminated
dough. It's like an
dough.
Empanada.
In
my experience, not laminated.
Well, I mean, it's a
tri-sub the other night.
You went to tri-sub? Yeah.
Yeah, I like that place. I've been there four or five times in the last year and a half.
We got a guy that we work with, Joe Carnahan, and he was, the reason it's on my radar is he was
that's good.
Offered to work there, to be the EC or the CPC there.
Well, they need another bartender, that's for fucking sure.
And he told me it was a Ukrainian restaurant, and that sounded really weird to me because like they're few and far between. You know, they're very, kind of a rarity.
Yeah. It's cool, it's hip.
I like it. Is it hip? I mean, I might go there.
They had live,
music, actually.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm open to it. If you think you want to go over there.
Yeah, let's fucking go.
We could have the Wheel of Fun.
What's the Wheel of Fun?
It's a Ferris wheel of shots because they make infused vodka.
I'm in. Yeah. Let's go.
It turns and it's got shots on it, and you choose four flavors or something.
Do they have caviar?
Each two people, so there are eight shots.
They gotta have caviar.
Probably.
But if they don't, they probably have amazing cheap eats. So, okay, cool.
Well.
Triza. We're reluctant.
So maybe not lemonade, but I remember the crust being kind of flaky.
Flaky?
Yeah. It was like a flaky kind of crust, but it was like an empanada. Meat filled,
big.
Served with the side of this big.
Yeah.
Served with the side of sour cream.
Yeah.
And then like some old Russian dude would like walk up with his dick out and be like, you guys want shots of vodka? And then they'd like give us a clementine to chase it with.
Only if you fucking poured in my mouth like a Shit, Ivan. Adam, what does perfect mean to you?
Perfect. Another one from the past. Perfect. The most cliche thing I could say would be to say that imperfection is the most perfect thing, right? But we talked about this in the last episode, maybe.
That's actually not the most cliche thing you can say.
No?
The most cliche thing you can say is perfection is unattainable.
Okay.
And therefore the question is invalid. Yeah.
Well, we talked a little bit about this in the last episode, and I think I came up with the perfect golf game. I think that it's a real thing.
Okay.
So you set out to achieve a goal and you accomplish it flawlessly, and that might be perceived as perception, you know, that's measurable perception or perfection. Mortal Kombat, flawless victory.
Mm. Yes.
You know, this exists.
It exists.
Yeah.
Fuck.
Okay.
Shit. I think we're done here.
Oh yeah.
I think so, actually.
Can we see it?
Yeah, we'll do a reveal. So the way I like to do this is I put up a little picture in picture, so I can take your seat and you can take my stance. And and then we can both be on camera together. All in one place, all for one purpose. So you'll see yourself on the screen if you want to come back here and look at the painting.
Yes. Oh, all right. Man, how many beers did we drink?
Enough. Just enough.
Oh, it looks fucking just like us.
I like how you got the eagle on there, or the Harley Davidson, the bars on there.
Yeah, you can't do text in a picture of this nature.
No.
The whole thing becomes about that, you know?
I think
that's great. That looks just like us.
I didn't really add any red into your shirt, did I? A little. I tried to play it down.
Oh, wow.
You got the beers, though, too. I like the beers.
That was very important.
Oh, we look good in this photo. Not as good as the painting.
Right.
Oh, that's awesome. You got the beers? That's six beers. Gotcha. So you... That was...
Well, you can't see the row underneath.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. 9, 10 beers that's here.
All right. We got the first one in. Ugh. You guys want to shoot some fucking bison vodka or whatever it's called?
Let's drink some bison vodka.
Let's try that bison stuff, huh?
Can I use the bathroom? Are we good?
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. You can call it cut.
And to those of you out in the real world, keep stopping. I'm gonna head out after we turn this rental car. But yeah, it's a bit of growth, yeah.